There is no man that exists on the face of the earth, no human, no creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whose last days are more moving, more important, more valuable than the last days of the best creature on the face of the earth, Rasul Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I bring to you the final days of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated authentically. In the 10th year of Al-Hijrah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delivered his last sermon in public to the largest amount of people in Mecca al-Mukarramah, called the farewell pilgrimage, Khutbatul Wada'. And I wonder what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to address the people in this final important sermon to the public. But to highlight the most important parts of it, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam began after praising Allah and sending his prayers and blessings unto his messenger. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, "Behold, learn these words that I'm going to tell you and pass them on to those who are absent." The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded them to lend him a very attentive ear and told them that they are not to practice shirk ever again, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbidden shirk to enter into the land of the Arabs, Mecca and Medina and its surroundings. And he also said that Iblis has given up on causing people in these lands to make shirk as a whole, as a nation. But it is the minor sins that Iblis or the Shaytan will continue to do, to whisper into the hearts of Muslims. Then he advised us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to worship Allah and obey His Messenger. He said that, "I have left you on a clear white page. Its night is as clear as its day. No one will err off it except those who are soon to destruction." The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then addressed us in the form or the advice of abandoning nationalism and racism. Our different colors, our different backgrounds, our different genders. He said, the attribute of jahiliyyah in relation to tribalism and nationalism is long gone for me, and I have placed it underneath my feet today. He said this in the Holy Land, in the sacred month, in the time of Hajj. He said, leave it, for it stinks. It's a stinking carcass, and I have placed it beneath my feet. For he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his final sermon, you are one ummah, brothers and sisters in Islam. And for a Muslim, towards another Muslim is like one body. If one part of their body is ill and is complaining of pain, the other one, the rest of the body stays up during the night, throughout the night, unable to sleep, full of fever and heat. These are among the primary advices that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us. He said to the men, look after your women. Why is the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving these strict advices in his last sermon? Yet today we find many Muslims not taking them as a very serious matter. He knows that our generations and our children cannot flourish, cannot be leaders without looking after the most important educational institution that exists for them, and she is their mother. For she spends most of the time with them. For Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took so much importance about caring and nurturing this mother. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created her from you, and she is an amana. The other important advice that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us is about riba. Why? Why such, you know, simple matters to us today? But they were so huge that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam needed to leave it with us as a bequest. Riba, is it not the result of most of our countries today, third world countries, dying of hunger and starvation? Poverty and oppression is the result, not primarily because of usury and interest. And the leading money makers are the capitalists, and they survive and thrive off interest and riba. This oppression creates classes of people and hierarchies. But Rasul said, leave it. Rasul then said again, repeating the brotherhood, saying, behold, the blood, the honor, and the wealth, the property of every Muslim is as sacred as this day of ours, as this month of ours, as this holy city of ours, if not more, even more sacred than the Kaaba itself. The blood, the honor, and the property of the Muslims towards one another. But the most highlighted advices are adhering to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not making shirk, brotherhood and sisterhood in Islam, caring for our women, and looking after the honor, the blood, and the wealth of one another. These advices were simple, yet the Muslims today, how far we have gone off track in these matters. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam finished his last sermon by pointing his finger upwards and then pointing to the people. O Allah, bear witness that I have informed them. Bear witness that I have informed them. He kept repeating it several times until the people wept. They felt the strain, the tension. After that, it was not more than about a month. In fact, on the 29th day of Safar, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had come back before that from a battle. And in that battle, he had eaten some food from Khaybar, and the food had been poisoned. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam felt okay after that. However, the pains of this poison was felt later on, about a month in the 11th year of Hijrah in Safar. He went to Al-Baqiyah. I wonder why Rasul ﷺ is going to the cemetery. Is it because Rasul ﷺ knows that his time is coming? Or is it that the Prophet ﷺ is informing us to remember death and to know that this is the reality which everyone shall be brought to, even the most beloved creature to Allah, who is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Al-Baqiyah, and with him was Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu and a few other companions. He made extensive long dua for the people of Al-Baqiyah and for the shuhada. He said, you have beaten us, and we will insha'Allah follow very soon. We give you glad tidings of Jannah. And then he said this following word, subhanAllah. I wish the only thing that I will miss is that I didn't get to see my brothers. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was standing there listening to this, and he was confused along with the companions. He said, Ya Rasulullah, are we not your brothers? Something gone wrong, Ya Rasulullah. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was moved. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him, and his face was tired, and he was slightly sad. He said, Ya Abu Hurairah, you are my companions. My beloved brothers and sisters are the ones who believed in me, but never had the chance to see me. I wish only that I could have seen them. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, will you ever be able to see these brethren of yours anyway? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ah, yes, as if I can see it. I will be awaiting for them at the Hawd, at the fountain of Kawthar, on the day of judgment, and I will call them one by one to come and drink from my hand. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was confused. He said, Ya Rasulullah, how will you know them when you have never seen them? And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me give you an example of a man who has many horses. Many of them are dark, pitch black in color. And among them there are horses with striped colors, white on their foreheads, white on their nose, on their backs, on their legs, on their tail. Is this person not able to tell the black horses from the ones that are striped very easily? He said, Yes, Ya Rasulullah. He said, on the day of judgment it will be so. They will come to me on the day of judgment like this. When everyone else, because of their kufr and because of their bad deeds, their bodies and their faces will turn charcoal, these people will come and they have different colors on their bodies. The color is Noor. Noor coming out from their faces, coming out from their arms, coming out from their legs. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu asked, "Where is this Noor from, Ya Rasulullah?" He said, "This is the result of the wudu which they used to make." As he was walking down from the Baqiya back to his house, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam felt a strong fever hit him like no fever he has ever felt before. It was on a Wednesday. Around him were some companions. And one of them was Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu. He said, "The Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I heard him say that Ibrahim alayhi salam said, 'Oh Allah, many of them, of the people who were supposed to follow me,'" about Ibrahim alayhi salam, "'have lost and gone astray. So whoever follows me is from me. And whoever disobeys you, then you, Allah, are the most merciful, the forgiving.'" Then he recited the verse about Isa alayhi salam. Isa alayhi salam said, "Oh Allah, if you punish them, then they are your servants. And if you forgive them, then you are the most honorable and the generous." Then the Prophet ﷺ lifted his arms up after reciting these verses. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As said, "Then we heard the Prophet ﷺ say the following words. If Ibrahim ﷺ said this in his dua, if Isa ﷺ said that in his dua, then as for me, Ya Rabb, O my Lord, save my nation, save my nation, save my nation." Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is farewelling, and the only thing on his mind is his ummah. He is leaving this world, and yet he is so caring for us, as though he knows we are going to go astray, we're going to have hardships without him, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so he made his famous dua. He said he started to weep and cry until his beard was soaked with tears. Then Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala said to Jibreel, "Ya Jibreel, go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and ask him what is making him cry, and his Lord knows why." So Jibreel alayhi salam said, "Ya Rasulullah, your Lord asked you why you are crying and he knows why." Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Ya Rabb, I want you to save my ummah. I fear for them." Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Jibreel alayhi salam, "Tell him that I will make him pleased for his ummah, and I will not make him grieve over them." Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. On the day of judgment, he will have al-wasila, the intercession which he has been promised. No other prophet will be given it except the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. On the day when we will go from Adam to Nuh to Ibrahim to Musa to Isa until finally Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, every one of them will refuse. They will say, "I have no power today. My Lord is so angry, he's never been angry like this before. Go to the one after me," until we reach Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that is the day when he will meet us again, inshaAllah, where he will raise his head and say, "Ya Rabbi, Allahumma ummati ummati." He reached his house sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he called his wives. He said to them, "Where do you think I should stay tomorrow?" And they knew why he was asking, and they all understood his love for Aisha radiallahu anha. So they all said with one voice, "You may stay at Aisha's house, Ya Rasulullah." So he went to Aisha radiallahu anha while his cousins and his relatives, Ali radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, Al-Fadl ibn Abbas, his other cousin, they were carrying him from his armpits. And his legs, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was sort of dragging on the floor. His head was kneeling to one side. He couldn't hold his head up, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The most who are tested in trials of hardship are the prophets. Then the ones who are most like them, and then the ones who come after them, the ones who come after them. Aisha radiallahu anha says, "There was no day more beloved to me and happy to me than the day when the Prophet sallallahu and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to my house. He placed his head on my chest here, and I said to him, 'Ya Rasulullah, wa ra'sah,' my head, I have a pain in my head for the first time in his life. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, without asking her or making dua for her, he said, "This time, Ya Aisha, it is my head. I am feeling extreme pain in reality." The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's fever increased. He could not stand up. He tried to stand to go into the masjid to pray the Maghrib prayer with them. But what happened? He fell sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the ground and fainted. And then when he awoke, he said, "Please bring water, 7 buckets of water, and spill them on me." And then he grabbed a little towel and started placing water on his mouth and on his forehead. And he said the following words, "La ilaha illallah. How perfect is Allah. Truly, there is agony in death." At that point, Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Bakr radiallahu anhu entered. And when he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this pain, he said, "Are you feeling pain, Ya Rasulullah? You, the Messenger of Allah?" Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, "I feel double the pain of what you, 2 of you strong men feel. Does that mean that you have double the reward?" He says, "Yes, not a single mu'min on the face of the earth who receives the prick of a needle of pain, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expiates their sins as a result." That night, Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was able to barely stand up. So he said, "Take me into the masjid." And the one who was leading the salat, it was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. How? Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Aisha radiallahu anha. He said, "Did the people pray yet?" She said, "Ya Rasulullah, they are waiting for you." Then he went unconscious again for a little while. Then he woke up again. And he said, "Did the people pray, Ya Aisha?" She replied, "They are waiting for you, Ya Rasulullah." So he called upon them to carry him inside. He saw them lining up. And he said, "Call Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to pray imam." Aisha radiallahu anha said, "Ya Rasulullah, people are a little bit disturbed because Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu cries a lot in his salat and his voice is not very loud. Let Umar radiallahu anhu pray. His voice can be heard more." Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam repeated, "Muru Abu Bakr falyusalli bil nas." They repeated, "But Ya Rasulullah, how about so and so?" He repeated a third time, and this time he said, "You are being like the women that betrayed Yusuf alayhi salam. Don't be like that. Muru Abu Bakr falyusalli bin nas." At that point, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was called to pray, but they had to look for him. Why? Because he said, "I did not want to take the position of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam while he's still living." So he was forced to pray imam. When Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wanted to move back. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam signaled as he came forward and he said, "Stay where you are." He ordered for a chair to be placed on the left side of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed imam while Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was next to him. After he finished the Isha prayer, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood up and he gave them the following words. I wonder what the first word of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say. He said, "Whoever of you I have harmed, whoever of you I have taken something from and I haven't returned it, today I give myself for anyone to take their right from me." And one man said, "Ya Rasulullah, you owe me 3 dinars." So he said to Ibn Abbas, "Give him." So he gave him Al-Fudayl or Al-Fadl ibn Abbas. Then one man said, "Ya Rasulullah, one time you slapped me on my stomach." The story of that was that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was straightening the lines and he went through them and he came to one of the men and his belly was a little bit outside. So he tapped it lightly, joking with him. He said, "Move this belly back, it's a head." Also indirectly giving him advice to go on a diet. So it was this man. He said to him, "Ya Rasulullah, you hit me on my stomach one time." Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lifted his shirt and he said, "Take your revenge." So the man came and he kissed Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's belly. said, Ya Rasulullah, I only did this because I wanted my mouth to be the last to kiss you. Subhanallah. Rasulullah then said, a man has been given an option between living on in this world or dying, and he has chosen to meet his Lord. Then suddenly, a man in the crowd burst into tears and he said, we sacrifice our mother and father for your sake, Ya Rasulullah. They looked and it was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. We were thinking, look at this old man. He's crying and wailing. And Rasulullah is just speaking about a man who was given the option between living more or going to his Lord, and he chose his Lord. Why is he crying like that? Then they heard the Prophet ﷺ reply and say, every door of the masjid is closed except for the door of Abu Bakr. Whoever wants to enter, enters through the door of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Everyone I have given the favors back except for the door of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. I have not been able to close the favors between me and him. He has given me so much that I will pass from this world and I still have not given him what he has given me. Radiallahu anhu. That's when they realized that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is farewelling. And when they realized that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was going to die, they realized that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was certainly the most knowledgeable of them. After that, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explained to them a long verse again about brotherhood, about unity, about obeying Allah and His Messenger, about looking after the Ansar. And he spoke so much about the Ansar that he said they're going to fall in number until they are like salt in a large cup of liquid among you. Look after them, care for them. And he made a huge dua for the Ansar, and he made a huge dua for the Muhajirin. Then he stepped down sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and entered his home. It was the next day on a Thursday. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's pain increased. And he remembered that he had 7 dinars. He said, Ya Aisha, I have 7 dinars. Give them away to the needy. Then he went unconscious. He woke up. He said, Ya Aisha, did you give away the 7 dinars? She said, Ya Rasulullah, we were busy with you. He said to her, what will your messenger say to Allah on the day of judgment when he meets him with 7 dinars? Give the 7 dinars away. He went unconscious and then he came back a third time and said, have you given the 7 dinars away? She said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. He said, Alhamdulillah. That night, Aisha radiallahu anha had to borrow from the neighbor a bit of milk just to feed those who were in the family, in her household. Abu Bakr radiallahu anha at this time is leading the prayers. Rasulullah was unable to pray with them. Every time he could get up, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would look inside and come back to make sure the rows are fixed. And every time he saw the rows are straight, Rasul ﷺ would be happy and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Rasul ﷺ could not walk and he could not speak. Upon him entered the brother of Aisha radiallahu anhu, and he had with him a miswak. Rasul ﷺ was looking at the miswak. Aisha radiallahu anhu, being a wife who understands her husband well, she said to him, do you want the miswak, Ya Rasulullah? And he nodded. So she took the miswak and Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam cleaned his teeth as good as he can. Then Aisha radiallahu anha grabbed the miswak after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and used it on her own teeth. She said, that was the last time I took the saliva of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and put it on my mouth. She said, I wanted his saliva to come to be a part of it. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam then at that point, she could hear him say some words. He said the following words, however, it is with the prophets and the martyrs and the Siddiqeen that I want to be with. The days passed. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam became more ill. However, on Sunday, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam felt a little bit better. So he asked for Al-Fadl ibn Abbas and Ali radiallahu anhu to carry him. They took him and he could speak. He opened the curtain and they were about to pray salat. He saw their line straight, all the Muslims in a row. And this brought a beautiful smile to his face. Is that not the symbol of unity and brotherhood, my dear sisters and brothers? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they saw him, the people were almost about to pray, but then they stopped. And they started to raise their voices in takbir, Allahu Akbar. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is better. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was about to move. But so Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, stay. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu prayed imam, while the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was too weak to join them. He went back inside. He had to lie down again, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he said the following words, and Aisha radiallahu anha could hear him. He was saying, no, it is the close friend, the high one, that I want. He is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want him, the company of the highest. Aisha radiallahu anha understood that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was being given the option between living or going. And he chose to go. The next day, it was a Monday, the same day Rasul ﷺ was born on, and on the Monday was the day when Rasul ﷺ departed. He was lying down after Fajr, he had prayed with them, alhamdulillah, entered the house of Aisha radiallahu anha, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he had gone back, he's going back to his house. Rasul ﷺ entered to Aisha radiallahu anha, and he had a severe pain in his head, and his fever started again. So he sat down and placed his head on her sternum again. And she said, I felt the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uttering words of his love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I felt his body getting heavier and heavier. I looked at him. And I saw his eyes looking up into the sky. The eyes follow the soul. Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died. Aisha radiallahu anha couldn't bear this. She placed him on the floor and ran outside of her house. The people could hear her. They knew that something was wrong. She said, Rasulullah, Rasulullah. The companions heard her and they raced back. What's happened? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has departed. There is no more wahi. There is no more Quran. There is no more Rasulullah. There is no more advice from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The world is nothing without him. There is no more blessing. Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has left them. What are they going to do? He was like a mother to them, like a father to them, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, more than their own fathers, more than their grandfathers, more than their children, more than anything. Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has departed the world with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The companions went into hysteria. They almost lost their minds. The companions said, Wallahi, there wasn't a sadder day than the day when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam departed. We could hear the Medina, it was like a thunder of cries and wails. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he heard this, he ran back to Aisha radiallahu anhu. He entered the house and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was covered with a Yemeni piece of material, very simple. They had covered his face with it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu took this cloth off and he began to weep, until his tears fell on the cheek of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He kneeled down and he kissed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face and said to him, you are so beautiful alive and so beautiful dead, my friend, my companion, ya Rasulullah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said, I covered his face and he went outside. He stood up and saw the people in such hysteria. Only Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was the true leader to set the people back on the track. He stood up and said to Umar radiallahu anhu, oh Umar, be quiet and sit down. But Umar radiallahu anhu would not listen. So then the people turned to Abu Bakr and came to him. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said the following famous words, Ayyuhannas, من كان يعبد محمد فَإِنَّ مُحَمَّدًا قَدْ مَاتَ وَمَنْ كَانَ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيٌّ لَا يَمُوتُ. And he recited the following verse, and Muhammad is nothing but a messenger like all those messengers who have passed before him. If he was to be killed or died, will you turn against yourselves away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and lose yourselves? Whoever does so, Allah does not need them, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward those who are grateful. At that point, all the Muslims fell to the ground and they said, Wallahi, it is as if the Quran was being sent down upon us like the first day we ever received. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu renewed it, subhanAllah. Truly, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew who had to take it after him. Umar radiallahu anhu fell down. He said, I could not feel my feet. He said, it is as if I am hearing the Quran for the first time. That is when Umar radiallahu anhu said, I then admitted and knew that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam truly, he has died.